prayer for spiritual hunger in my life. From the early days of my salvation, 20 years ago, I caught a hold of Matthew 5 where Jesus says, blessed, happy are the ones who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Those words jumped off the pages and laid hold of me. I made a vow in my early days that I would be the hungriest man that had ever lived. I had no clue what I was praying, what I was asking. I didn't know what it would look like, but I'm like, God, I want to live forever grateful for all you've done, forever more hungry for the more of God. Never let me be satisfied. Never let me fall complacent. But God, would you constantly wound me with fresh hunger for you all the days of my life? And over the last 20 years, I have found that prayer coming back to the forefront again and again and again. I have found over the last 20 years that whenever God wants to birth a new season in my life, He will always birth a new hunger in my heart, a new hunger for more. It's in those seasons that I become disillusioned with my own life and my own place of intimacy with God, intimacy with the Word, power and holiness. And it's in those seasons where I become disillusioned that He wounds me afresh, saying, Corey, there is more. And as He wounds me, I begin to cry out, God, give me more. I want the blessing of hunger and thirst. I want righteousness in every area of my life, my soul. I want that rawness, that desperation, that reach of my heart for more of God. And He's always answered me with this cry. And today, God, I cry out, God, birth a new hunger for you in my heart. Birth a new hunger in my life for you, Jesus. You show us in the Gospels that there are simply people who laid hold of you and received things from you that other people did not receive. Their levels of humility and desperation and hunger, they provoke me, Jesus. When I read of the Canaanite woman in Matthew 15, she had no plan Bs. Her daughter was severely demon-possessed, and she comes to you, and it's so messy, it's so ugly, and yet she comes to you and says, please, set my daughter free. Set my daughter free, and you didn't even answer her. She pressed through the first denial, and she went after the disciples, saying, if I won't get it from you, I'm going to get it from your disciples. And the disciples cried after you, saying, Jesus, get her away from us. This is uncomfortable. It's awkward. It's messy. You said that you were only sent to the lost sheep of Israel. But what did she do? She came and she worshiped before you, and she says, Lord, help me. You then declared, you said, it is not good to take the children's bread and to throw it to the little dogs. You called her a dog. You cut her deeply, but you're not even worth it. What did she do? She took that offensive statement from you and she turned it into intercession. She goes, yes, Lord. But even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. My gosh. She could care less about what she looked like in front of other people. She'd care less. She cared less. She goes, I am a little dog and I'll take anything that falls from your table, Jesus. Jesus, I want to be like that woman. You turn quickly and you say, great is your faith. You have what you desire, and the daughter was set free. God, I want a hunger, God, that presses through all the barriers, all the denials, all the obstacles, all the offenses. I want to press through it all and turn it into intercession. Make me like this woman, Jesus. Release a raw, desperate, ravenous hunger for more of you in my soul for breakthrough. I want greater breakthrough of you in my soul. I want greater intimacy with you, Jesus. I want greater intimacy in your word, Jesus. David cried it in Psalm 119. He says, my soul breaks with longing for your judgments at all times. Oh, my soul breaks with longing. Jesus, I want to be like blind Bartimaeus. In Mark 10, it says that you came into Jericho, and as you were leaving Jericho, this blind man began to cry out from the depths of his soul, Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me. All the people around him began to tell him to shut up, be quiet. This is not a time to look messy. This is a time to look refined. But he cried out all the more. He pressed through everybody's opinions of him. He cried out all the more, make me like that man, Jesus. I want to press through what other people think. I want to press through what my own soul tells me. You stopped. You stopped dead in your tracks, Jesus. And you asked that blind man one question. What do you want me to do for you? You became a blind man's servant. He goes, I want to see. My prayer today, Jesus, is that I want to see you. I want greater intimacy with you. I want greater encounter with you. I want greater fellowship with you, Holy Spirit. I want to feel what you feel, know what you know, think how you think. I want to see. God, raise up a generation, Lord, that would cry like Bartimaeus, that would press through the religious, that would press through the dullness of their own hearts until you stop dead in your tracks. God, make me like the woman with the issue of blood. She spent all of her livelihood on physicians and she could not be healed by any. But something came into her heart, and it was that if I could get a hold of the hem of his garment, I would be healed. She pressed through the crowds. She pressed through the people. And she laid hold of you, Jesus. She touched you. You didn't touch her. She touched you. I want to touch you. I want to touch you. I want those words to come out of your mouth like they did for her when you said, who touched me? Who touched me? I don't want to just be around you, Jesus. I want to touch you. Oh, God, I want to pull your life, pull your power, pull your virtue out of your life, into my life, into my family, into my home, into my region. God, I want to pull it. Release a spiritual hunger, God, that would pull on you and to see breakthrough in my own life, see breakthrough in my own family, breakthrough in my own city. I want to touch you, Jesus. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They shall be filled. Oh, John G. Lake said it, if there's one gift that I could give to mankind, it would be the gift of hungering for God. It doesn't matter whether you're a stay-at-home mom or I'm a pastor or a person. It doesn't matter what I do in this life. But that there's one irreversible law of the kingdom, and it's called hunger. You will not deny a hungry person. You will not deny a hungry man, a hungry woman, a hungry child. But you will fill them. God, I ask you to raise up and release a Psalm 42 people in this hour as the deer pants for the water brooks. So pants my soul after you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, the living God. But all the voices around me tell me to give up. When I see no breakthrough in sight, I will thirst for you, Jesus. When your waves and your billows crash over me, I will thirst for you, Jesus. When doors seem to be locked and shut, I will not, Jesus. When I see no breakthrough in sight, I will press, Jesus. This is my prayer to the God of my life. Baptize me with spiritual hunger all the days of my life. From glory to glory to glory, God. Never let me arrive until I see you face to face. Never let me settle, Jesus, until I see you face to face. Wound me with spiritual hunger. Wound me with desperation. Wound me, Jesus, all the days of my life. Cut me again. I never want to become domesticated. I never want to become a professional Christian or a professional minister. I want to be desperate for you, Jesus. So I ask you right now, baptize me with longing. Baptize me with thirst. Baptize me with hunger. Panting after you, Jesus. I ask you, Father, right now, all over the earth, wound a generation with spiritual hunger. Open the floodgates of heaven over them and undo them with your glory.